Hello everyone, this video is about IV fluids. As we all know, IV fluids has an unavoidable part in every clinician's practice. We encounter variety of situations that require the use of IV fluids, and there are variety of fluids available which vary in their composition. So it is very important to know which fluid to be used where and how. Now let's have a look at all these in a nutshell. First of all, what are the goals of using an IV fluid? They are used to normalize the hemodynamic and electrolyte abnormalities, to maintain daily requirement of fluid and electrolytes, to replace previous fluid and electrolyte losses, to replace ongoing fluid and electrolyte losses. They also provide nutrition and are also used as a source of IV drug administration. Based on these goals, we can classify IV fluids simply as crystalloids and colloids. Crystalloids mainly contain water, electrolytes and glucose. Colloids are albumin and blood products which maintains the oncotic pressure. Before moving into detail about each IV fluid, we should have an idea about the normal fluid distribution in our body. In an average 70 kg man, 60% of the lean body weight consists of water. That is around 42 liters. Out of this, 2/3 remains in the intracellular compartment, that is 28 liters, and 1/3 moves into the extracellular compartment, that is 14 liters. And we know that the extracellular compartment consists of the intravascular and interstitial components. 1/4 of this fluid moves into the intravascular compartment, that is 3.5 liters, and the rest 3/4 moves into the interstitial compartment, that is 11.5 liters. Any imbalance that occurs in this normal fluid distribution requires an attention to maintain the equilibrium of the body. In such cases, IV fluids can be maintenance fluids or replacement fluids. Maintenance fluids, as the name indicates, are aimed at maintaining normal fluid level by replacing the lost fluids. Fluid loss in the normal body can be either sensible or insensible losses. Sensible loss includes our daily urine output, and the insensible loss consists of respiration, perspiration, and stool. The daily urine output accounts to be around 500 to 2000 milliliters, and insensible loss is around 8 to 12 milliliters per kilogram per day, and they also increases 10% for every 1 degree Celsius increase above 32.2 degrees Celsius. So when we calculate this losses, in an average 70 kilogram man, the insensible loss will be around 560 to 840 milliliters per day. And combining this with the daily urine output, we get the daily loss of water as 1000 to 2000 milliliters, which is around 30 milliliters per kilogram per day. Not only fluids, but electrolytes are also lost along with it. The daily requirement of sodium is around 1 to 2 milliequivalents per kilogram per day, and that of potassium is half of it, that is 0.5 to 1 milliequivalents per kilogram per day. So in an average 70 kilogram man, the daily requirement of sodium is 70 to 140 milliequivalents, and potassium is 35 to 70 milliequivalents. That was the basic concept that we need to know about the normal fluid balances in our body. Now let's move on to the IV fluids proper. First of all, let's discuss the contents of some commonly used IV fluids. We'll be discussing under the topics osmolality, that is the number of dissolved particles in a fluid, and the amount of sodium, chloride, potassium, calcium, lactate, and glucose. The most commonly used solution is our sodium chloride solutions. They are available in many formulations. First of all, the normal saline, that is 0.9% of sodium chloride, half of normal saline, which is 0.45% of sodium chloride, 1/4 of normal saline, that is 0.225% of sodium chloride, and 3.33 times that of normal saline, that is 3% of sodium chloride. The osmolality of normal saline, or 0.9% of sodium chloride, is 308, and that of 0.45% of sodium chloride is half of it, that is 154. That of 0.225% of sodium chloride is 1/4 of that of 0.9% of sodium chloride, that is 77. And for 3% sodium chloride, it is 3.33 times that of 0.9% of sodium chloride, that is 1000. 26. The amount of sodium and chloride are equal in each solution. In normal saline, it is 154 each. For 4.45% of sodium chloride, it will be 1 by 2 times that of 0.9% of sodium chloride, that is 77 each. And for 0.225% of sodium chloride, it will be 1 by 4th that of 0.9% of sodium chloride, and that is 38 each. For 3% of sodium chloride, it will be 3.33 times that of normal saline, that is 513 each. And normal saline solutions does not contain potassium, calcium, lactate or glucose. Next most commonly used solutions are our 5% dextrose solutions. We have 5% of dextrose in water, 5% of dextrose in normal saline, that is our DNS, and 5% of dextrose in half of normal saline. We also have 5% of dextrose in 1 by 4th of normal saline. In each of these solutions, the amount of 5% dextrose is 50 gram per liter of the solution. In 5% of dextrose with water, the osmolality is constituted by the 5% dextrose and it is 278 milliosmoles. In DNS, we have both 5% dextrose and 0.9% of sodium chloride. The osmolality will be the total of that of 5% dextrose and that of 0.9% sodium chloride, that is 278 plus 308, which is 586. And the amount of sodium and chloride is that of normal saline, that is 154 each. In 5% dextrose with 0.45% sodium chloride, the osmolality will be 278 plus 154, which is the osmolality of 0.45% sodium chloride. So the total osmolality is 432 and the amount of sodium and chloride is 77 each. In 5% dextrose with 0.225% sodium chloride, the osmolality will be the sum of 278 plus 77, where 77 is the osmolality of 0.225% sodium chloride, which is 355, and the amount of sodium and chloride will be 38 each. Moving on to the next most commonly used solutions, we have the Hartmann solution, where the osmolality is 279 with sodium 131, potassium 5, calcium 2, chloride 111, and in addition to all these, they have lactate at the amount of 29 milliequivalents. The next solution is plasmalite A with an osmolality of 294, sodium 140, potassium 5, and instead of calcium, it has got magnesium at the amount of 3 milliequivalents. Chloride is 98, amount of lactate is 8, and it also has acetate, which is 27. In addition to that, they have gluconate, which is 23 milliequivalents. In Ringer's lactate, the amount of lactate is 28 with osmolality 272, sodium 130, potassium 4, calcium 3 and chloride 109. So we have seen many components in all these solutions. Why are we worried about these particles? Actually, these particles are the osmolality of the solution that is actually determines the fluid's distribution. How does fluids get distributed? It is mainly based on tonicity. Tonicity is the amount of solutes that is present in the solution. Based on a solution's tonicity compared to that of plasma, it can be either isotonic, hypertonic, or hypertonic. In an isotonic solution, the tonicity of the solution is same as that of plasma, and so there is no net movement of fluid into or out of the cell. The most common example for this solution is 0.9% of sodium chloride and is used in extracellular fluid volume depletion. The main indications include treatment of hypernatremia in hypovolemic patients, treating saline-responsive metabolic alkalosis, used in hypernatremia in patients with hypertension. They are the fluid of choice in patients requiring contrast study. They are also used to treat shock and ARDS. Next is hypertonic solution, where the tonicity of the solution is less than that of plasma. As a result, there is net movement of water into the cell, leading to swelling of the RBCs followed by its rupture. The most common example is 0.45% of sodium chloride and is used in ECF and ICF volume depletion. The main indications include treatment of hypernatremia in hypovolemic patients and to maintain basic requirement of sodium. Next is hypertonic solution. Since the tonicity of the solution is greater than that of plasma, there is net movement of water from the cell into the plasma. As a result, the cell can shrink. The most common example is 3%, 5% and 7.5% of sodium chloride, and they are used to treat symptomatic hypernatremia, traumatic brain injury, burns, and also to treat hypertension and muscle cramps in hemodialysis patients. Now let's see how our body handles each solution. About the sodium chloride, the most commonly used solution is 0.9% of sodium chloride. We also have hypotonic solutions like 0.45% of sodium chloride and 0.225% of sodium chloride. The hypertonic solutions include 3%, 5% and 7.5% of sodium chloride. When we infuse the sodium chloride solution, there is 20% of increase in the intravascular volume, and also the solution remains in the vascular volume for around 30 minutes. So how does our body handle this 0.9% of sodium chloride? Suppose we are infusing 1000 ml of 0.9% of sodium chloride, the amount of fluid that remains in the intracellular fluid compartment is almost zero, and the amount of fluid that remains in the extracellular fluid compartment will be 1000 milliliters. That is, the total 1000 milliliters of sodium chloride moves into the extracellular fluid. And we know that the extracellular fluid compartment consists of the intravascular compartment and the interstitial compartment. 25% of this 1000 ml moves into the intravascular compartment, and the rest 70% moves into the interstitial compartment. That is 250 ml and 750 ml respectively. To conclude, when we infuse 1000 ml of normal saline, 250 ml of this solution remains in the intravascular compartment. So there is increase in intravascular volume, right? An acute increase in intravascular volume will cause the mean systolic filling pressure or right atrial pressure to increase, leading to an increased preload. And according to Frank Starling's law, this increases the cardiac output and finally the blood pressure. So what are the side effects of this sodium chloride solution? The main side effects include hypernatremia, osmotic demyelination, hyperchloremic metabolic acidosis, acute kidney injury, and increased plasma osmolality. Moving on to 3% of sodium chloride infusion. Now let's move on to 3% sodium chloride. How does our body handle 3% of sodium chloride? Let's see what happens when 1 liter of 3% sodium chloride is infused. Initially, the fluid volume is 42 liters. After infusion of 3% sodium chloride, 1 liter, the fluid volume increases to 43 liters. The plasma osmolality is 280 milliosmoles initially. So the total osmolality will be 42 into 280, that is 11,760. After 3% sodium chloride infusion, it will be 11,760 plus 1026, that is the osmolality of 3% sodium chloride. So the total osmolality will be 12,786. The extracellular fluid osmolality will be 14 into 280, that is 3920. Here 14 is the extracellular fluid volume. After 3% sodium chloride 1 liter infusion, the osmolality will be 3920 plus 1026, that is 4946. The intracellular fluid osmolality will be 7840, that is 28 into 280. 28 is the total intracellular fluid volume. Even after 3% sodium chloride infusion, the intracellular fluid osmolality remains the same because we know that 3% sodium chloride remains in the extracellular fluid compartment. So the intracellular fluid osmolality after 3% sodium chloride infusion will be 7840. This means the plasma osmolality now is 12,786 divided by total fluid volume, that is 43, which is 297 milliosmoles. Initially it was 280. As a result of 3% sodium chloride infusion, the plasma osmolality has increased. We can calculate the extracellular fluid volume from this, that is osmolality of extracellular fluid volume after infusion of 3% saline is 4,946 and the new osmolality is 297. So the extracellular fluid volume will be 4,946 divided by 297, which is 16.6. Initially, the extracellular fluid volume was 14. Now it is 16.6. So there is an increase of 2.6 liters. The intracellular fluid volume can also be calculated. The osmolality being 7,840 and the fluid osmolality being 297, the intracellular fluid volume will be 7,840 divided by 297, that is 26.4 liters. The initial osmolality, initial intracellular fluid volume was 26.4 liters. So there is a decrease in intracellular fluid volume. Finally, we can conclude that after 3% sodium chloride infusion, there is an increase in extracellular fluid volume, decrease in intracellular fluid volume, and an increase in plasma osmolality. The intracellular fluid volume decreases by around 1.6 liters. As a result, the brain edema reduces since the fluid moves from the cell into the intravascular compartment. And we have also seen that the extracellular fluid volume increases by 2.6 liters, or we can say that the blood volume increases by 10%. This will trigger the baroreceptor reflex, leading to inhibition of ADH secretion and finally renal water excretion. This can also stimulate atrial natriuretic peptide release, leading to the inhibition of renin-angiotensin-aldosterone system and finally causing natriuresis plus diuresis. So the net effect of infusion of 3% sodium chloride will be reduction in brain edema plus natriuresis and diuresis. Moving on to the infusion of half normal saline or 0.45% sodium chloride. What happens when 1000 ml of half normal saline is infused? And this 1000 ml of half normal saline actually contains 50% of normal saline, that is 500 ml, and 50% of free water. So there is 500 ml of normal saline and free water each. Moving on to this free water, we know that 2/3 of this fluid moves into the intracellular compartment, that is 333 milliliters, and the rest 1/3 moves into the extracellular compartment, that is 167 milliliters. Out of this 167 milliliters in the extracellular compartment, 25% remains in the intravascular compartment, that is 42 milliliters. And the rest 75% moves into the interstitial compartment, that is 125 milliliters. About this 500 ml of normal saline, it is completely extracellular as we have already seen. Out of this 500 ml extracellular normal saline, 25% is in the intravascular compartment, that is 125 milliliters, and 75% is in the interstitial compartment, that is 375 milliliters. So in a total, we get 25% of intravascular compartment water of free water, that is 42 milliliters, and 25% intravascular volume of normal saline, that is 125 milliliter. We have total intravascular volume as 125 plus 42 milliliters, that is 167 milliliter, which means the intravascular fluid volume after infusion of half normal saline is 167 milliliters, and in case of 0.9% of normal saline, it was 250 milliliters. To conclude, more amount of water remains in the intravascular compartment after infusion of normal saline when compared to half normal saline. The next solution is 5% of dextrose. 5% dextrose solution contains 50 gram of dextrose and 1000 ml of free water. Out of this 1000 ml of free water, 2/3 remains in the intracellular compartment and 1/3 in the extracellular compartment, that is 670 ml and 330 ml respectively. Out of the 330 ml in the extracellular compartment, 25% is in the intravascular compartment and 75% in the interstitial compartment, that is 80 ml and 250 ml respectively. So what happens after the infusion of 5% of dextrose? The initial osmolality was 280 milliosmoles per liter and the total osmolality will be 11,760 milliosmoles per liter. After the infusion of 5% dextrose 1 liter, the osmolality will be 11,760 divided by 43. That is, the total fluid volume has increased by 1 liter. So the osmolality now is 273 milliosmoles per liter. This means that the osmolality has decreased by 7. A decrease in osmolality by 7 or 2.5% will trigger the osmoreceptors, causing the decrease in ADH production, leading to increased renal water excretion. Next is dextrose in saline solutions. We have 5% dextrose plus 0.9% sodium chloride, 5% dextrose plus 0.45% of sodium chloride. We also have 5% dextrose plus 0.225% of sodium chloride. The peculiarity of this solution is that it gets rapidly distributed into the total body water. It also contains sodium chloride and 170 kilocalories per liter of the solution. And so they are used as maintenance fluid. It also provides calories, that is 170 kilocalories per liter, and they are used in the treatment of hypernatremia. The complications of this solution includes hypernatremia, cellular edema. Next is Hartmann solution. Hartmann solution, as we all know, contains lactate, and lactate is metabolized in liver producing bicarbonate and dextrose, which provides calories and energy. This solution, like sodium chloride, also remains in the intravascular compartment for around 30 minutes. What happens when we give Hartmann solution in patients with liver failure? Actually, it is contraindicated in patients with liver failure, as the conversion of lactate into bicarbonate does not occur, which leads to lactic acidosis. It also causes hyperkalemia, mostly in patients with renal failure, as the solution mainly contains potassium. Hartmann's also contain calcium, which binds with citrate in stored blood, causing clotting of blood when given with IV sets containing stored blood. We have already seen about the most commonly used crystalloids. Now let's move on to colloids. Colloids have a property that it can maintain the fluid volume within the intravascular compartment. That is, it maintains the oncotic pressure. What are the properties of a colloid? Colloid should be isotonic with plasma. It should mainly remain in the intravascular compartment with a half-life of around 6 to 12 hours. It should increase the cardiac output as well as the blood pressure. Colloid should not be antigenic or allergic. Colloid should not interfere with blood coagulation. And colloid should not cause infections. Colloids are mainly classified into natural and artificial colloids. Natural colloids are blood products and albumin. Albumin, we have 4.5% albumin and 20% albumin, which contains albumin at the amount of 45 gram and 200 grams respectively. Sodium is around 160 and 120 respectively, potassium 10 and 2 respectively, and chloride 160 and 40 respectively, with an osmolality of around 300 for 4.5% albumin and 135 for 20% albumin. The artificial colloids include dextran 40, dextran 70, gelatin, and hydroethyl starches. Since we have discussed about the crystalloids and colloids, now let's move on to the final part, that is the phases of fluid therapy. Fluid therapy is an early intervention in the management of acutely ill patients. The selection of resuscitation fluid should be based on the patient's clinical context. The need for fluid therapy in critically ill patient is not static, but it varies depending on the hemodynamic status. Therefore, a conceptual model for fluid therapy has been proposed. This model actually includes four phases, that is the rescue or salvage phase, which is characterized by life-threatening shock, that is hypertension and poor organ perfusion, which requires rapid fluid bolus therapy. Next is the optimization phase, which is less life-threatening and requires fluid bolus of around 250 to 500 milliliter in 15 to 20 minutes to restore the cardiac output and organ perfusion. The third phase is our stabilization phase. During the stabilization phase, fluid management is aimed at maintaining adequate intravascular volume, that is maintenance of fluid balance. The last phase is the de-escalation phase. De-escalation phase is characterized by measures of recovery, including weaning from ventilator and vasoactive support and treatment of volume overload by appropriate measures. It should be noted that these phases are not mutually exclusive but interrelated. A final word on some common situations requiring fluid resuscitation. First is situation of volume contraction, which occurs in cases of severe dehydration. The fluid of choice is 0.9% of sodium chloride, but if there is many solute loss, the fluid will be Ringer's lactate. The infusion should be continued until the BP and urine output is improved. The next situation is that of septic shock, which is characterized by altered vascular permeability, fluid leakage into extravascular space, and multi-organ involvement. The fluid of choice is always 0.9% sodium chloride and Ringer's lactate. The third situation is hemorrhagic shock. If the hemoglobin is less than 7, our aim should be at infusing PRBCs, and if the hemoglobin is stable, we should focus on maintaining the intravascular volume by infusing 0.9% of sodium chloride. So friends, that was in a nutshell about IV fluids. Hope the demonstration was useful and simple. Please give your feedback and suggestions for more videos in the comment box. Thank you.